Well, morning everyone. If you're a car driver, hopefully you can remember the days when we could get in the car and drive to anywhere you wanted to. But I wonder if you know where most accidents in the car happen. If you're a driver, do you know where most bumps in the car actually happen? I don't mean on the car, I mean whereabouts. Well, the answer is it's within just 5 minutes of your house. Nearly a third of bumps in the car happen within a couple of miles of where you live. So why do you think that is? Well, experts think it's because when we're somewhere really familiar that we know really well, we tend to concentrate a bit less. We tend to lose concentration. Now, I think our Bible story this morning is really, really familiar to many of us. And if you grew up in church, my guess is you may have heard it in Sunday school more than once, and perhaps with a picture a bit like this one, which hopefully is going to come up on the screen, of the fiery furnace in Daniel chapter 3. And that and the later story of Daniel and the lion's den a few chapters later might be some of the best known stories, I'm guessing, in the Old Testament. Which is great. They're great stories. But I think that that familiarity does bring a couple of challenges to us. Firstly, I think the stories can be so familiar that, like drivers near our house, we can stop paying attention to them. I think we can lose concentration a bit, and there's a danger that we think we know the story well and we stop trying to listen carefully to what God has to say to us in his word. I think that's one danger. And as I've thought about this story and its familiarity, I think there's a second possible danger for us. And that is that it gets filed in our minds, perhaps subconsciously, a little bit like a fairy story, like a fable, something out of Harry Potter, a kind of crazy story that's been made up. And we can stop thinking about it as a real event with real people. But the people were real. These were real people. In fact, you can read all about King Nebuchadnezzar II in the history books, and I've been reading a bit about him this week. Hopefully you've got a picture of him coming up. He was the king of ancient Babylon. If you want to know the dates, he reigned from about 605 to 562 BC. He was actually the longest reigning and most powerful monarch of the Near Babylonian Empire. He was born in the southeast of Babylonia in Chaldea, and in our story we're going to read about the Chaldeans. When he was the prince, when he was a young man, he joined the army. He led an army actually with the Medes, and they defeated the Assyrians and the Egyptians under Pharaoh Necho. So by the time he'd come to the throne, the king in our story, he was already quite a war hero. And Babylon was considered by many people to be the centre of the world in its time. I'd love to see its ruins, although I don't think travelling to Iraq is too much on the cards at the moment. But apparently the sites in Babylonia, ancient Babylonia, is the largest archaeological site in the Middle East. It would be great to see. And we know that Nebuchadnezzar was a great builder. He built, or had built for him, lots of palaces and temples to their many gods, especially the god Marduk, a bridge over the Euphrates. And I think Simon showed us a few weeks ago, if you were in the service, a picture of this a well-known grand processional way and a gateway, a fabulous gateway called the Ishtar Gate that was lavishly decorated with brick. And again, I hope we've got a picture. At the Ishtar Gate, I was interested to see, I don't know if Simon saw this when he was looking at this, but there was an inscription found on it, and it includes these words. I, Nebuchadnezzar, laid the foundation of these gates down to the groundwater level and had them built out of pure blue stone. Upon the walls of the inner room of the gate are bulls and dragons, and thus I magnificently adorned them with luxurious splendor for all mankind to behold in awe. This is the kind of guy King Nebuchadnezzar was. We know that from history. Some people think that these walls and the gate of Babylon were so amazing, they should have been included on that list of ancient wonders of the ancient world that are always so rather hard to remember. This is the great empire in our story then, and it's an empire that's attacked Jerusalem, as Karina was reminding us earlier. It had plundered the city of Jerusalem, took many of the people as captives back to Babylon, including these four young men, Daniel, and his three friends, who we know mostly by their Babylonian names, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, men who distinguished themselves in this new city and were given positions of importance. So let's first of all just set aside perhaps an idea that some of us might have had subconsciously, that this is a bit of a fairy story. And shall we just stop for a moment and ask God to help us to hear it anew this morning? To be able to go back in our minds and our imaginations, perhaps 2,500 years, to see that glittering gold statue on the plains of Dura, to hear that cacophony of instruments, maybe even to smell the smoke of the furnace. Shall we ask him to bring it to life for us this morning? And most of all, let's ask the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego to speak to each of us from this story this morning. So, shall we just turn to God in prayer again? Father God, we thank you for your word. And we thank you for this account that you have caused to be recorded for us in the book of Daniel from so many years ago. We do pray, Father, that you would speak to us this morning through your spirit from this story this morning. Please tell us more about yourself. Please reveal to us more about you and how we should live to please you. Please challenge us where we need to be challenged. Please encourage us where we need to be encouraged. And please give us open hearts, Lord, just to be able to hear you, Lord, and to be able to act on what you tell us. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. So, quite a long story, as Karina said, in chapter 3. And she has very helpfully, thank you, Karina, summarised for us the first few verses, and I've given these first few verses the title of Choice, because our three heroes of the story, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, are told you must fall down and worship the image of gold. This huge statue has been set up then, this huge awe-inspiring statue, 90 feet high. It must have dominated the landscape if you think of huge structures that you might have seen. And as Karina has also reminded us, and if you were in the service last week, you'll remember that Nebuchadnezzar had a dream that was interpreted by Daniel. And that dream was also about a statue. And if you remember, Daniel had explained to the king the meaning of the dream. It meant that Nebuchadnezzar's own kingdom would not last forever. Do you remember the statue had a head of gold and that represented Nebuchadnezzar and his empire? But it was not going to last forever. It would be succeeded by a succession of different kingdoms. And the conclusion of the dream was that actually none of these kingdoms would last. Instead, they would all be surpassed by God's kingdom, represented by a rock. It would smash these other kingdoms, but God's kingdom would come and would last forever. Now, I don't know if it was that dream that inspired Nebuchadnezzar to make this statue. I don't know. Maybe having been warned that his kingdom wouldn't last forever, he thought this was a good way of shoring it up, of strengthening it, of strengthening his hold on the people. And maybe he should have focused a bit more on the rock than on himself. Well, we don't know. But what we do know is that the statue's been set up. And on the dedication ceremony day, a huge crowd was there, including all these different levels of government authorities from different places under Nebuchadnezzar's rule. And it was all going to plan for a while. Well, why wouldn't it? Because everyone's been told what they must do. And they've been told what will happen if they don't. If they don't bow down and worship the statue, they will be thrown into a furnace. Horrific. and presumably the furnace is standing nearby. And again, we've got a picture of a sort of furnace of those days. And maybe it looks something like this, where the top was a bit like a sort of chimney for the smoke to escape, and also could be useful for throwing things or even people into it. And then a sort of door near the bottom where the fuel and the air would go in. So again, don't think this sounds too far-fetched. And as I was reading about historical Babylon, I was really interested to read that archaeologists found a furnace like this one. I mean, it probably wasn't the one in the story, but it was a furnace that was clearly used to fire bricks. It was a kiln for firing pottery and stuff. And on it was an inscription in cuneiform. Is that how you say it? In cuneiform. And the inscription said, "This is the place of burning where men who blasphemed the gods of Chaldea died by fire." So clearly this wasn't a very unusual way of getting rid of people who did the wrong things, horrific sort of execution. And as we've seen in chapter 3, some of the king's counselors notice that Shadrach, Meshach and Abednego have not bowed down. They have disregarded the king's authority. They have not obeyed. I don't know if these other men were motivated by jealousy of these foreigners who've risen so far in the king's service, but they pointed out to the king, "These men have not obeyed you. What are you going to do?" Why won't they bow down when the consequences are so awful? Why didn't they bow down? What a choice they made that day. Well, of course, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego knew the stories of their people. They knew the history of the people. They knew that the God, the creator of the universe, the one God, had revealed himself to them as the all-powerful God, the God who'd made covenant promises to their ancestors. And it was a God whose first commands were that we, his creatures, must acknowledge who he is, that he is the only one we should bow down to in awe and worship. "You shall have no other gods before me," he had said. "You shall not bow down to anything else or worship it." In fact, he said, if you go into a land as conquerors and there are idols, statues of other gods there, you've got to get rid of them. You are God's people. You're to be holy. You're to be set apart just as God is holy. And Shadrach, Meshach and Abednego would not compromise on that, whatever the consequences would be. Because remember, I expect you know how the story ends, but they didn't know how it would end. They didn't know how it would end. And they made a very brave decision to obey God's command to be holy and set apart, not to worship other gods. They obeyed God's command rather than the king's command. Would I have made the same decision in their place? Would we do it now? Well, you might say that's ridiculous. I'm not going to be asked to worship a golden statue of the Queen or Boris Johnson or something like that. Perhaps not. But you know, it's true that like these men, like Shadrach, Meshach and Abednego, we, you and I also live in a culture where most people don't acknowledge that God is God. And in a sense, we too could be called exiles in a foreign country. Well, we know, of course, that there have been many followers of Jesus in history and actually in parts of the world today, where following God's way has led to death, will lead to death. But it's not our situation, is it? However, when you or I make a decision to follow God's way rather than what society tells us, every time we do that, it does bring consequences. And I know that many of you will have experienced some of those consequences in your lives. I mean, at the very least, it's likely to bring misunderstanding or disapproval, maybe even from people we care about. Why are you doing that? Following God's way might mean difficulty ahead. It might mean cutting out some habits that we like. It might mean getting rid of comforts we enjoy if we feel that they are taking the place of God. In our growth group last week, someone in our group told us that quite a few years ago, I think, that God had challenged them about some music that they listened to and the place that music was beginning to take in their life. And actually, as a consequence of that, they ended up deciding to get rid of that music. Now, I believe this is a challenge to all of us from this story today. Does God really take first place in my life? Does God really take first place in my life? Do I take his word seriously? Because we should. I guess that Lent has traditionally been a good time to examine ourselves. And maybe this is a good time for you and I to ask God to show us, are there areas in my life where perhaps I'm compromising God's word to fit in with what everyone around me does or what I want? Do I excuse, I don't know, breaking the speed limit or tweaking the lockdown rules if it suits me? When God's word tells me that we should obey the law, unless to keep that law would mean disobeying God? Am I making compromises around my relationships or the things that I watch or the things that I read? Because God's word tells me I should strive to be holy, to be pure. So I think, first of all, this morning, it would be good to pray to ask God if he is challenging us on some of those things. It might be that he wants to challenge us on some things in our lives, whether we really are acknowledging that he is God and that his word is to be obeyed. And if he does challenge us about that, then we need to act, because he's a holy God and rebellion against God is serious and we should take it seriously. So even though it might be difficult, it might mean some difficult decisions to obey his word rather than doing what society around us expects. We remember, as Karina was saying earlier, God doesn't promise us a life without trials or pain. He does promise us some wonderful things we're going to look at later, but he doesn't promise us a life of comfort. So first of all, let's take that challenge seriously, perhaps this week, maybe later today or later in the week. Let's resolve, each of us, to take some time before God to ask him to show us, is there something that I need to change in my life with your help? Is there something you need me to cut out of my life or to take a different place in my life if it's beginning to take the place of God? Are there areas of my life where I am not looking, first of all, to honour God? Are there compromises that I'm making that I shouldn't? We're going to go on with the story now, and Julian's going to read us the next section, which is from verses 13 to 23. Thank you.
Furious, King Nebuchadnezzar ordered Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego to be brought in. When the men were brought in, Nebuchadnezzar asked, "Is it true, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, that you don't respect my gods and refuse to worship the gold statue that I have set up? I'm giving you a second chance. But from now on, when the big band strikes up, you must go to your knees and worship the statue I have made. If you don't worship it, you will be pitched into a roaring furnace, no questions asked. Who is the God who can rescue you from my power?" Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego answered King Nebuchadnezzar, "Your threat means nothing to us. If you throw us into the fire, the God we serve can rescue us from your roaring furnace and anything else you might cook up, O King. But even if he doesn't, it wouldn't make a bit of difference, O King. We still wouldn't serve your gods or worship the gold statue you set up." Nebuchadnezzar, his face purple with anger, cut off Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. He ordered the furnace fired up 7 times hotter than usual. He ordered some strong men from the army to tie them up, hands and feet, and throw them into the roaring furnace. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, bound hand and foot, fully dressed from head to toe, were pushed into the roaring fire. Because the king was in such a hurry and the furnace was so hot, flames from the furnace killed the men who carried Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego to it, while the fire raged around Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego.
Thank you. Wow. The story is hotting up a bit in every sense of the word. So here's our next section then, which we called courage. If the first section was challenge, this section is called courage. And there's a declaration of these men: we will not serve your gods. And the king is incandescent with rage when he hears about these men who won't obey his command. And I guess as what we've seen about Nebuchadnezzar II, he wasn't too used to people disobeying his words. However, he seems to have given them a sort of second chance, doesn't he? If we look back at verse 15, you know, is this true what I'm hearing, that you won't obey me? We're going to do this and you're going to do that. And if you don't, are you sure you know this is what's going to happen? Because disobedience is going to mean punishment immediately. Then what God will be able to rescue you from my hand? What God can do this? Nebuchadnezzar knew about lots of gods, but he himself had immense power. If I decide to do this, what God could possibly rescue you? What courage these men show in replying to the king. They're not going to worship his gods. They're not going to bow down to his statue. Where do they find the courage to do such a brave thing? How do we find the courage to stand up to things that we know are wrong? Well, as we've seen already, their courage comes from knowing who God is. And they know that he is the God who saves. He is the God who saves. How do they know that? They know he's the God who saves. They know he's the God who hundreds of years before had promised to deliver his people from captivity in Egypt, and he did. His people saw him do it in power by sending plagues and parting the sea and all sorts of miraculous things. Those stories have been told and retold and retold to the generations. They knew that if they identified with this God, if they were his people and obeyed him, he would save. He would restore. They knew what kind of God he was. Their hope was in him. They believed that whatever happened to them, God had promised to deliver. They believed. They didn't just know who God was. They believed it. Maybe they would die in that furnace. There could well be suffering ahead. It looked like it, didn't it? But even if he does not rescue us from the furnace, we will not serve your gods. Even if he doesn't rescue us. I wonder if, amongst many things we can see in this story, there's a good answer here to whether we should always obey those in authority. And maybe that question is occurring to you as we listen to the story. Well, should we always obey the government or those who rule over us? Well, briefly, I think the Bible's pretty clear on that. And in Romans 13, amongst many other places, we're told that it is a good thing, pleasing to God, for us as Christians to obey the authorities in our land. The only exception being where if obeying a human authority might mean to disobey the clear command of God. If a human authority clearly commands us to obey what God has clearly forbidden, that might be an exception. But I think Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego are great examples to us here in the way they spoke to the king with respect. They weren't trying to overthrow him. They weren't trying to get other people on their side and lead a rebellion. But they did respectfully and fairly quietly make a stand and refuse to go against God's command. Because this command to worship the statue was a clear violation of God's law. And this was a stand that they had to make. So let's get on to the climax of the story. And again, Julian's going to read us the next section from verses 24 through to 30.
Suddenly, King Nebuchadnezzar jumped up in alarm and said, "Didn't we throw three men bound hand and foot into the fire?" "That's right, O king," they said. "But look," he said, "I see four men walking around freely in the fire, completely unharmed. And the fourth man looks like a son of the gods." Nebuchadnezzar went to the door of the roaring furnace and called in, "Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, servants of the high God, come out here." Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego walked out of the fire. All the important people, the government leaders, and the king's counselors gathered around to examine them and discovered that the fire hadn't so much as touched the three men. Not a hair singed, not a scorch mark on their clothes, not even the smell of fire on them. Nebuchadnezzar said, "Blessed be the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. He sent his angel and rescued his servants who trusted in him. They ignored the king's orders and laid their bodies on the line rather than serve or worship any god but their own. Therefore, I issue this decree: anyone, anywhere, of any race, color, or creed who says anything against the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego will be ripped to pieces, limb from limb, and their house is torn down. There has never been a God who can pull off a rescue like this." Then the king promoted Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego in the province of Babylon.
So here we are then in our last section of the story. And if the first sections we titled, what was it? Challenge and Courage. I think we come on to our last section, which was titled Confidence. Can we get the picture of confidence? I think it's coming up. And this statement of these three men, the God we serve is able to save us. Do you remember Nebuchadnezzar had asked, what God could save you from this? And they said, the God we serve is able to save us. Sometimes God rescues from the fire. And sometimes God allows us to go through the fire. But with this difference, we go through the fire with him. I was also very drawn this week, without really talking to Karina or Judy, who read to us earlier, to that passage in Joshua of God's promise to be with his people in all situations. As we come to the climax of this story then, the three are thrown into the inferno, and to his utter astonishment, the king sees not three figures just tied up and burning in the flames, but he sees them walking around unharmed in the fire. And in fact, not just three figures that have been thrown in, but four. And the fourth figure is not a mere man, to be sure. And at the end of the story, out come Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. They're unharmed and they're unsinged, and they don't even smell of smoke, which if you've had the fire pit like the Tuckers had this week, you'll know is surprising by your circumstances. And King Nebuchadnezzar begins to realize just who their God really is. We know, like these men, that God does not promise us a life free from suffering or trials or pain. Because we live in a world, don't we, that's been broken and deformed by humankind's rebellion against God. And the consequences of human sin and rebellion fall upon us quite randomly sometimes, don't they, in all kinds of ways, in all kinds of suffering, and even in death. In fact, God's word tells us to expect suffering and not to be surprised by it. In fact, as we've seen, following God's way might itself bring exclusion or ridicule or pain or suffering. So that leaves us with a question, really. In the face of this suffering of the world, is the follower of God in any better position than anyone else? Or do we all just suffer together the same? is there any difference? If we all experience suffering, well, is there any difference for God's people? And the answer is yes. There is every difference. There is every difference because he is the God who saves. And even if he allows suffering to come to us in our lives, he is with us in it. And that makes all the difference. We've seen some wonderful verses, haven't we, from scripture this morning, where God promises never to leave us. For example, Psalm 46, he is our refuge and our strength, our ever-present help in times of trouble. And therefore, we will not fear whatever happens to us. Or the words of Isaiah 43, where God says, when you pass through the waters, I will be with you. Or as he said to Joshua, I will be with you. Don't fear. Be courageous. Last week, I was listening to a Zoom event one evening. It was run by a local church and it was focusing on the topic of mental health. And a friend spoke on it, actually. He's someone a little bit older than Julian and I. And he's been a follower of Jesus for many years. And he described his personal battles over the years with very severe depression. He's a follower of Jesus. His depression hasn't gone away. He still goes through times of battles of depression. He hasn't been rescued from them yet. And he was asked in this discussion, what was it like when times are particularly bad for you? How do you pray in those times? And he said, actually, I can't really find words to pray when it's really, really bad. Maybe except help God. But he said, he knew that God, even in those worst of times, he knew that God was with him. He knew that God was there. What God will be able to save you, said the king. The God we serve is able to save us. He's a God who saves. He's promised time and time again, as we've seen, that he won't leave us in times of trouble because he walks through the fire with his people. He walks through the fire with us. If you don't remember anything else from this morning, let's remember that. He walks through the fire with us. But secondly, what could be better news than that he walks through the fire with us? Well, not only does he do that, but God has walked through the fire for us. God has walked through the fire for us. Now, Shadrach, Meshach and Abednego had confidence in this God that they'd heard about, this God they'd been taught about, the God they knew protected his special people. But you and I have much, much more than that. We have, and we've been reminded this morning, haven't we, taking communion together, we have God's ultimate story of salvation in Jesus. Because in Jesus, God walked through the fire for us, the fiercest fire of human sin, God walked through it for you and for I. And so we know there is an ultimate salvation. Whatever happens to us in this life, and God will be with us through all of it, there is an ultimate salvation. Not because we're strong and we can stand up and we can do it well, but because Jesus walked through that fire for us. There will be suffering in this life. We've seen that. We live in a broken world. It won't always be easy to follow Jesus. But we've been reminded, haven't we, looking at these stories from Daniel in the last few weeks, that this message of Daniel again and again is that God is God. God reigns over this world. It's not random. God reigns over this world and he will bring his purposes about. It looked like Nebuchadnezzar had all the power in the world. But, you know, by the end of Nebuchadnezzar's life, if you know the next few chapters of the story, you'll know that he came to recognize that it is God who rules. And he came to praise the Almighty God. So like Nebuchadnezzar, may it be true for you and I that we come to recognize that this Almighty God is also the God who saves us. And whatever we go through in our lives, whatever we might go through, whatever we're going through now, he has promised never to leave you. Even in the valley of the shadow of death, we can know his grace and his presence in all our circumstances. We don't always get it right. We don't always manage to make a stand. We let God down. We don't always manage to be holy. But the really great news is that because Jesus walked through the fire for us, we can trust him to save us. He has saved us. He ultimately will bring us home. And in that home, there will be no more suffering. Even death itself will be finished, will be over forever, because the God we serve is able to save us.